This morning, I'd like to talk about our universe and its age and the evidence for creation. Now, if you go out into the country, far away from the city lights, and you look up on a bright on a dark night, you see all these beautiful stars, and it is very easy to affirm what King David wrote, that the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament, or the expanse, shows his handiwork. But we're being told that that's not the case. We're being told that the universe is not God's handiwork, but rather is the result of an explosion of sorts. And I put that in quotes because it's not a conventional explosion, but it is an explosion of sorts called the Big Bang. And the Big Bang has lots of problems with it. We could spend an entire talk just on problems with the Big Bang. One of these problems is they have a hard time explaining the origin of stars. Now, they do have an idea. They do think that stars form from these giant gas clouds. And the thinking is that if you can have this shock that can compress a gas, this gas sufficiently, then gravity can take over and you can have nuclear fusion begin. So what causes these shock fronts? Well, one of the popular ideas is that it's coming from an exploding star. Okay, so basically they need stars to form new stars, but that obviously raises the question, where did those first stars come from? Okay, and there's lots of other problems with this thinking as well. But a critical part of this Big Bang story is that the universe is unimaginably old. They would claim it's almost 14 billion years old, and yet Scripture teaches that the universe is young, roughly about 6,000 years old. And naturally, people wonder, well, is the Bible wrong? Is the Bible wrong about the history of our universe? Well, I'm here to assure you that it's not wrong. It's absolutely correct. And I want to reassure you that recent creation is reasonable. The popular media, and I guess you could call it the big science establishment, wants you to think that if you hold to a recent creation, you're committing intellectual suicide. That there's no way that any reasonable person can believe that the universe is just a few thousand years old. But I want to assure you that's not the case. First, science cannot prove that the universe is old or young. If you're looking for a slam dunk, airtight argument from science that the universe is old, we can't give it to you. And the reason for that is really pretty simple. It's because age isn't something that's measured in a laboratory. Every time a scientist talks about an age or an estimated age of a rock or anything like that, these are calculated numbers based on assumptions about the past. We weren't there in the past, okay? So we're having to make these assumptions, and those age estimates are only as good as the assumptions behind them. Now, creation and secular scientists have different starting assumptions. We affirm creation and a global flood, but secular scientists deny those things. Now, secular scientists will disagree about a lot, but they are all adamant that God did not make the universe in 6 days and there was no global flood that destroyed the world in the days of Noah. That's one thing they all agree on. And they hold to a philosophy called uniformitarianism, which can be summarized by the motto, the present is the key to the past. And so they would claim that the processes we see going on today, operating at more or less the rates and intensities they do today, are sufficient to explain Earth history. So if you apply uniformitarianism to geology, a geologist would say, well, erosion is slow today, therefore it's always been slow. And they would argue that it took millions of years for the Grand Canyon to be carved out slowly and gradually. So science cannot prove a young or old universe, okay? However, even when we make uniformitarian assumptions, most age estimates are consistent with biblical creation, but not with the Big Bang story. And what I mean by that is uniformitarian is wrong. We're going to see some evidence that it's wrong. But even if we, for the sake of argument, make assumptions that are generous to uniformitarianism, generous to the Big Bang, generous to evolution, nearly all of the maximum ages for these space objects are much too young for the Big Bang story. But because these are maximum ages, the true ages could be just 6,000 years. So as an example, we're going to see evidence that spiral galaxies, secular scientists claim they're billions of years old. The Milky Way galaxy is supposed to be around 13 billion years old. But we're going to see indications that they can't be anywhere that old, that you're at an upper limit might be a few billion, maybe 5 billion years. or 300 million. You know, there's a range there depending on the assumptions we make, but you've got pretty much a hard upper limit of a few billion years. And so that's a contradiction with the Big Bang story. Okay, but that's a maximum upper limit, so could the true age be just 6,000 years? Yes. Now, one of the questions that always comes up when you're having this discussion is, what about distant starlight? Now, you've got galaxies that are billions of light years away, and since a light year is the distance traveled by light in a year, presumably, the argument goes, it would take billions of years for that light to reach us. Now, this is something that creationists are still working on, but I want to show you this issue is not quite as simple as everybody makes it out to be. The behavior of light is really strange. Okay, it's the speed of light is always 186,000 miles per second, and it doesn't matter whether the light source is standing still, moving toward you, or moving away from you. Now, if you think about that, that is very counterintuitive. Okay, that completely contradicts our common sense understanding of the way velocities should add and subtract. Okay, but that thinking is what led to this fact that light behaves in this weird way. That's one of the things that led to Einstein's theory of relativity, in particularly his special theory of relativity. And that's where you have these weird effects where clocks can tick at different rates depending on differences in speed and gravity. So I'm arguing that it's a mistake to reject biblical creation because of this issue. It's something we're still working on, although some creation scientists think the problem has already been solved in principle, but it's not something that's easy to explain. So the first point here is that the speed of light's really weird, okay? So this is not going to be as simple as everybody thinks it is, and that weirdness led to relativity theory, and a lot of creationists think that the correct solution to this question involves relativity theory in one form or another. And furthermore, the Big Bang also has versions of this problem. It's got at least two versions of this distant light travel problem that creationists also have. So I'm arguing that it is a mistake to reject biblical creation just because of this one issue. I think when we look at the preponderance of evidence, it clearly favors a recent creation. It doesn't prove a recent creation, okay? Because again, you always have to make these assumptions about the past. But I think we're going to see that these give us hints that the universe is much younger than we're being told. And finally, I want to point out that biblical young universe assumptions have allowed a creation physicist, not me, but someone else, to make a bunch of successful predictions about the magnetism of bodies in our solar system. You may have heard people say that creation scientists never make predictions, but we're going to see that that is not true in this discussion this morning. So we're going to start outside our Milky Way galaxy, and we're going to take a little tour of the local cosmic neighborhood, and we're going to zoom in and fly into our solar system. And our sun, like other stars, supposedly, according to the evolutionists, formed from a rotating cloud of gas and dust. And there's a lot of problems with this idea. We mentioned one of them earlier. They call this the nebular theory. It's changed a lot over the years. But one big problem with it is that it may violate an important rule in physics called conservation of angular momentum. And Neil deGrasse Tyson, who is no friend of the creation movement, said a number of years ago, the scary part is that if none of us knew in advance that stars exist, frontline research would offer plenty of convincing reasons why stars could never form. So it is very tough to explain naturally, you know, apart from a supernatural explanation, how you can have trillions of stars in the universe. Now, our star is very well behaved. It shows evidence of design. There are other stars similar to our sun that can emit big blasts of radiation once a century, what you call super flares. Now, our sun has flares too, but those flares are mild, and it's a good thing that God designed our sun that way, because otherwise we would be in a lot of trouble. Okay, if one of those super flares happened on our sun, it would ruin everybody's day. Okay, so our sun, it shows evidence of creation, evidence of design, and I'm going to argue that the idea that it's billions of years old actually presents problems for the evolutionary story. There was a famous solar physicist named John Eddy. He studied the sun, and he made some ripples, waves a while back when he said that he thought astronomers could live with an age of 6,000 years for the earth and the sun. Now, he was an evolutionist. He believed the sun was billions of years old, but he said, as far as the actual astronomical evidence is concerned, he thought an age of 6,000 years was reasonable. Also, the idea that the sun is billions of years old, it actually presents a problem called the young faint sun paradox. And it's kind of ironic, but it was the late Dr. Carl Sagan who was one of the first people to point this out. He was always trying to convince us that the universe is billions of years old. But he realized that based on ideas about how stars slowly evolve over billions of years, he realized that billions of years ago, supposedly when life was just getting started, the sun would have been about 30% dimmer than it is today. Now, the problem with that is that would mean that the Earth was getting a lot less sunlight, and that means the Earth would have frozen. Now, the problem is most evolutionists think the Earth was warm at the time that life was supposedly getting started, and therefore you have a contradiction where one part of the Big Bang story is contradicting another part, and they call this the young faint sun paradox. Now, every now and then you will see headlines in the science media claiming they've solved this problem. Here's one from 2010. But then they pointed out the next year, oops, well, no, actually, we didn't solve it after all. Here was another trial balloon in 2013, but they're still working on it back in 2016. So you get the idea, okay? They claim to have solved this problem, but no, they really haven't, okay? And so that's an indication that our sun is younger than what they're claiming, because you don't expect the brightness of the sun to change that much over just a few thousand years. Now we go to the innermost planet in this, and that's Mercury. And it may just be me, but I think the Lord's probably going to make us change the names of these planets when he comes back. I just have a hunch about that, given that he is a jealous God. But, you know, Mercury has indications of youth. It has a magnetic field. Now, why is that a problem if you believe in billions of years? Secular scientists think that a planet or moon has to have a molten core in order to have a magnetic field. Now, the problem is when you have small bodies like Mercury or the moon or whatever, they lose heat relatively quickly. So secular scientists were completely surprised to find that Mercury has a magnetic field, because it should have cooled off billions of years ago, and it should no longer have a molten core. Okay, that's the problem. So this looks like Mercury is young. And Russ Humphreys, he's a creation physicist who's done a lot of work on magnetism, both here on Earth and in outer space. He predicted back in 1984 that older volcanic or igneous rocks should contain a record of past magnetization. Well, guess what? When the Messenger space probe flew by Mercury, sure enough, there was evidence of magnetism in these rocks that were thought to be quite old. Now, we don't accept that age estimates of billions of years, but these radioisotope dates can be correct in a relative sense, though not in an absolute sense. Russ Humphreys also predicted that there would be a significant decrease in what we call the magnetic dipole moment of Mercury. Now, that's just a number that tells you how big the biggest part of the magnetic field is. And he didn't get this exactly right. He actually underestimated a little bit. It would actually turned out to be 8%. But remember, secular scientists didn't think Mercury would even have a magnetic field at all, let alone that was changed, one that was changing so rapidly. Now we're going to go to a visitor to our inner solar system, a comet. And of course, you know that comets are these dirty snowballs, and every time they come near the sun, these ices on the comet nucleus vaporize and form these beautiful tails. So every time they come near the sun, they're losing mass, and so they're kind of like melting ice cream cones. Now, secular scientists claim these are leftovers from the formation of the solar system 4.5 billion years ago. Well, why then do we still see these comets? They have finite lifetimes. Why do we still see them? Now, they're aware of this problem, but they would claim that these comets are being replenished by these reservoirs of potential comets. And because the different comets have different orbital characteristics, they need more than one reservoir. One of them they call the Kuiper Belt or the scattered disk, and there's another one that they call the Oort cloud. And there's problems with this idea. For instance, these comets that are thought to be what they call Halley-type comets, They thought, well, maybe we can explain them by the scattered disk, okay, which is a part. It's these bodies that are part of what they call the Kuiper belt. Well, they realized there's not enough mass there to make that work. So they thought, okay, well, what about the Oort cloud? Maybe the Oort cloud could be the source for these Halley-type comets. Well, the problem with that is that even as Carl Sagan acknowledged, there's no direct evidence that the Oort cloud even exists. Okay, so there's all these problems with this, these ideas. They don't work very well. In fact, we actually see evidence from individual comets that they're very young. Comet Hartley 2 is still outgassing carbon dioxide. And secular scientists were shocked by this because they thought, if this thing is 4.5 billion years old, all of this volatile CO2 should have vaporized a long time ago. They said it was inexplicable as to how this comet could still have carbon dioxide in it. But it is a lot easier to explain if that comet is much younger than they're saying, if it's just thousands of years old. Now we're going to go to Venus, and Venus spins backwards. That's a problem for the secular story, because if you say that the solar system formed from a rotating cloud of dust and gas, everything ought to spin the same way. Well, Venus doesn't, and so that's a problem for the secular story. Moreover, there are recent lava flows on Venus, and the cratering is uniformly distributed. There's not that much of it. That's an indication of relative youth for the surface of Venus. Now, secular scientists still would say this is maybe 700 to a billion years old, but they would argue that something catastrophic happened to repave the surface of Venus. Maybe 700 to a billion years ago. Now, they don't like that. Planetary scientist said he doesn't like uniformitarianism. Remember, we talked about uniformitarianism earlier. But he said, I don't know how to explain this apart from a catastrophe. Now, why is it that secular scientists are so averse to catastrophism? Well, I'm going to argue that it's because if you need catastrophism to explain the geology on Venus, you may need catastrophism to explain the geology on Earth. And what if there's geological evidence that that catastrophe involved lots and lots of water and sounds an awful lot like the Genesis flood? I think that will go a long way to explaining why they are so averse to this idea of catastrophism. Now we go to the third planet from the sun. Hopefully everybody recognizes this one. This is our home Earth. 71% of it is still underwater. Most of the land surface is covered by what we call sedimentary rocks, and even evolutionists acknowledge those are nearly always, almost always deposited by water. And within those sedimentary rocks are the fossilized remains of billions of plants and animals that had to have been rapidly buried in order to fossilize. So these rocks in the Grand Canyon, those are water-deposited rocks, and we are arguing that these are from the Genesis flood. So if those rocks and fossils really were formed during the Genesis flood 4,500 years ago, well, where's the evidence for millions of years? Okay, it's not there. We're claiming that these rocks and fossils are not evidence for millions of years. They're evidence for the flood. Furthermore, we have evidence that the Earth is young, and I'm just going to focus on one particular example here, and that's the Earth's magnetic field. Secular scientists have admitted they have no idea how the Earth's magnetic field could be sustained for billions of years. Now, they have a theory that they call the dynamo theory. They've been working on it for 100 years and still haven't been able to get it to work. And this scientist here, not just 6 years ago, said, look, we don't understand how the Earth's magnetic field has lasted for billions of years. We have less of an understanding now than we thought we had a decade ago. It's even worse than that because if you look at measurements of the strength of the magnetic field that have been made within the last 150 years or so, it's obvious that the energy of the magnetic field is rapidly decreasing, decreasing by about half every 1,400 years. Well, if you run the numbers backwards, the energy would be so great that the current needed to drive that field would be enough to melt the crust and the mantle. The Earth's magnetic field and the Earth can only be thousands of years old. I mean, we're looking at tens of thousands of years. 100,000 years is probably an extremely generous upper limit. And by the way, Russ Humphreys also predicted that volcanic rocks would show evidence of rapid magnetic reversals. We think those were triggered by the flood. And sure enough, he predicted this in 1986, and There was a paper published in 1989 where they found evidence of these rapid magnetic reversals happening in days, okay? And that was shocking to secular scientists. And that was confirmed. There was another paper published in 1995, and others have also confirmed this as well. And that was a totally shocking idea for the secular scientists. Well, we're going to move on now to our nearest neighbor in space, and that's the moon. And evolutionary scientists have a very hard time explaining the moon's existence. In fact, one Harvard astrophysicist is reported to have joked, the best way to explain the moon is that it doesn't really exist. Okay, we only think we see it there. It's not really there. Okay, so I guess the moon's playing peekaboo with us or something. I'm not sure how that's supposed to work. But there's lots of evidence that the moon is young. There is evidence of recent geological activity. There are these embankments called scarps on the moon that are a clue that the moon has recently cooled off and the crust has actually shrunken a little bit. Moreover, there's evidence that geological activity is very likely still going on. There are things called transient lunar phenomena where you will sometimes see flashes of light on the moon, hazes, colors, and some of those are meteorite impacts, but some of those could be evidence of ongoing volcanic activity on the moon. And there's evidence that the moon is experiencing moonquakes even in the recent past. And this completely shocked the secular scientist because basically that would imply that the moon still has enough energy to drive this geological activity. And they were thinking the moon should have cooled off billions of years ago. And so for a long time, it was settled science, quote unquote, that the moon had been geologically dead for the last 3 billion years. We now know that's not true. Furthermore, there's evidence that the moon had a strong magnetic field in the past, and it's even harder for secular scientists to explain that than it is to explain the magnetism on Earth. And one of the reasons for that is because the moon rotates so slowly. It takes a whole month to spin once on its axis. So now we're going to go to the red planet, Mars. And secular scientists want very much to find evidence of life on Mars. They think this will make the evolutionary story seem more plausible. They haven't found it, and I don't think they're going to, especially intelligent life. I don't think there's any chance of that. But they want to find life desperately. If they can't find life, they want to find water because they think water, if you get water, supposedly that shows life can evolve. But there's evidence of catastrophic flooding on Mars. Now, today, there's not a drop of liquid water on the Martian surface. But they're okay with the idea of catastrophic flooding, and creationists are too. We just think it's a little ironic that we live on a water world where there's all this water, and we have all these water-deposited rocks, and they will tell you there's no evidence for a worldwide flood. Now, we think that's a little bit inconsistent. By the way, Russ Humphreys made another prediction. He predicted that older volcanic rocks on Mars should have evidence of past magnetism, and sure enough, that was confirmed. You've got these craters in the southern hemisphere where you've got magnetic fields that have been preserved. Again, we don't accept those age assignments of billions of years, but these are rocks that are presumably older on Mars, and they have that remnant of magnetism that Russ Humphreys predicted. So now we're going to head on to the outer gas giants. And of course, we have Jupiter that's well known for its size and its great red spot. Jupiter gives off twice as much energy as it receives from the sun. And so it's like a potato that you've taken out of the microwave. It's cooling off. It's losing energy. It's relatively warm. I mean, these are still cold temperatures according to our everyday experience, but it's relatively warm. And that's hard to explain if you think this thing is really billions of years old. Now, secular scientists are aware of this. They've come up with different ideas to try to explain this, but there's problems with all of them. The simplest explanation is that Jupiter is simply young. It's still cooling off. From the energy, it's still losing that energy that God gave it at creation. Now, Io is the most volcanically active body in the solar system, and it's a small body, okay? It takes energy to drive that volcanism. The question is, how can it have maintained that energy for billions of years? Now, the story that is, there is a mechanism that secular scientists will invoke to explain this. It's something called tidal flexing, where you have these gravitational tugs that can stretch and compress the crust, warming it up. But it's not clear that that's enough to do it. Maybe it is, maybe it's not. But also, the rate of the volcanism is so high that if the volcanism were going on at just 10% of the rate that it is today, over geological time, the entire mass of the planet would have been erupted or 40 times. Okay, that's kind of stretches credulity there. Okay, now there's another moon. One of the other Galilean moons is Ganymede, and it's got a magnetic field, and that too is a surprise for secular scientists. Because again, it's small, it should have cooled off billions of years ago, so you shouldn't have a magnetic field. And the tidal flexing argument doesn't work as well in this case because Ganymede is farther away from Jupiter. So if it's billions of years old, its magnetic field should have disappeared long ago, but it could still have a magnetic field if it's just 6,000 years old. Well, now we're heading on to Saturn, which is renowned for its beautiful rings, and those rings actually show indications of youth. Those rings are made up of these icy particles, and those particles are being constantly bombarded by space dust and micrometeorites. And so they ought to be dark and sooty after billions of years, but they're not. They're very bright and shiny. And so even the secular scientists have been forced to acknowledge that these rings are relatively young. Now, they will still say they're hundreds of millions of years old, but that's an upper limit. They can't be older than that. Now, could they be younger? Could they be just 6,000 years old? Yes. And so that's another indication of youth that we see inside the solar system. We can also go to one of Saturn's moons. That's Titan. It's unusual in that it has an atmosphere, and there's some methane in this atmosphere. Now, that methane is being broken down by solar radiation, and there's no evidence that it's being replenished. And that puts an upper limit of something somewhere between 10 and 100 million years on the atmosphere of Titan. Okay, that's an upper limit. Could it be younger than this? Yes. Yes, it could. And so again, practically everywhere we look in the solar system, we see these indications of youth. Now we go to Uranus. And Uranus is unusual in that it's tilted sideways. The other planets spin like tops. Uranus rolls along like a wheel. And that's an apparent problem for this nebular hypothesis. Now, to be fair, there was a paper published this year where they claimed that they could explain this with meteorite impacts or impact events. I think I find that a little hard to believe because it's not just the planet that's tilted sideways. The rings are as well, and so are these moons. I'll admit I haven't looked at their code that they use to do their calculations, but I'm skeptical that that would work. But we also see evidence of youth in Uranus. Back in, again, 1984, Russ Humphreys predicted a particular value for this magnetic moment. That little squiggly sign means about, because we didn't have enough information to make a number, predict a number that was more precise than that. But sure enough, when Voyager 2 flew by, and 2 years later, Humphreys was right. He was correct in his prediction. And Humphreys took seriously 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 5, that talks about that by the word of God, the heavens were of old and the earth standing out of the water and in the water. And Russ Humphreys speculated that God made the heavenly bodies out of water and that initially their magnetic dipole moments were all aligned. And then he made some simple assumptions, turned the crank, and was able to make these predictions. And he did the same thing, not just for Uranus, but he did it for Neptune. Now, Neptune is radiating heat, is losing energy 2.5 times faster than it's receiving it. Again, that looks like it's young. How is it managing to show this evidence of relative warmth if it's billions of years old? Well, again, Russ Humphreys, he also predicted a magnetic dipole moment of Neptune, and sure enough, he got that right as well. Now, so how are the secular scientists doing with their predictions? Well, one physicist said this in 1989, "You would have thought we would have given up guessing about planetary magnetic fields after being wrong at nearly every planet in the solar system." So creation scientists have a far better track record on this than do secular scientists. Russ Humphreys has made multiple successful predictions about the magnetism of these heavenly bodies. Now, we're going to take a look at Pluto as well. It recently was demoted to a dwarf planet, and we learned a lot about it because of the New Horizons flyby about 5 years ago. But secular scientists were very surprised that Pluto is geologically active. They were shocked by that because Pluto is so tiny. It's way, 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 way far away from the sun. It's tiny. You would think it would have cooled off quickly. So why is it still geologically active? In fact, if you look at the left lobe of the heart on Pluto, there's not a single crater there. And secular scientists think that can only, the maximum age there is 10 million years. They think something happened to repave that part of the planet, which I think is reasonable because even in a universe that's just thousands of years old, you might expect to see a few meteorite impacts. The problem is, okay, that geological activity that would be required to resurface that part of the planet takes energy. And they are very, they have a hard time explaining how Pluto could maintain that energy for billions of years. There was a paper they published this year that was sort of a trial balloon, but I'm not really convinced that they've got a good explanation for that. But I want to point that out just to be fair to them. That was inside our solar system. Let's go outside our solar system. Let's go outside our Milky Way galaxy. It's a spiral galaxy, and these spiral galaxies slowly rotate. But not all the parts of the galaxy rotate at the same speed. The parts closer to the center rotate faster than the parts that are farther out. And as a result of that, you get this winding up of the spirals, and eventually they're going to be very tightly wound, and then eventually you're not going to see any spiral structure at all. It'll just be a flat disk. So if these galaxies are around 10 billion years old, why do they look like this and not like this? Okay, that's evidence that these spiral galaxies are much younger than we're being told. Now, secular scientists know about this. They're working on an explanation for this. They call it the density wave model, but they've been working on it since the 1960s, and even secular scientists acknowledge there's problems with it. The simplest explanation for the continued existence of this spiral structure is that these galaxies are relatively young. We're going to go ahead and take a look at something else that is of interest, and that is these hot blue stars. This particular hot blue star is one of the stars in Orion's belt. And hot blue stars, the very hottest blue stars, they ought to burn out and explode in less than 3 million years. And so the obvious question is, if the universe is billions of years old, why do we still have these hot blue stars? Well, secular scientists will claim that new stars are being formed, but you saw earlier that there's problems with that. Okay, the simplest explanation is that these stars are young. And so, God deserves the glory for making these beautiful stars. The Bible says he knows their number, and he has a name for every single one of them. And he, not quote-unquote nature, deserves the glory for making this beautiful universe. So again, recent creation is reasonable. Despite what they're going to try to make you think, you're not committing intellectual suicide by holding to a recent creation. Again, if you want a slam dunk argument from science that the universe is old or young, we can't give it to you. But we see lots of clues that suggest that it's a lot younger than what we're being told, even when we make assumptions that are favorable to the Big Bang story. And finally, young universe biblical assumptions has allowed Russ Humphreys, a creation physicist, to make multiple successful predictions about the magnetism of bodies in our solar system. Now, this shouldn't surprise anybody because the Lord Jesus himself implicitly affirmed recent creation when he said from the beginning of the creation, God made them male and female. Not billions of years after an alleged Big Bang, but from the beginning of the creation. And there's two other verses in the Gospels where if you think carefully about what the Lord Jesus is saying, he is implicitly affirming a recent creation. So the Lord deserves the glory for this. As the psalmist wrote, "Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him, for he spake and it was done. He commanded and it stood fast. So these are some of the sources that I used to put together this presentation. And I hope that's been a blessing to you. And I hope you'll sign up. If you haven't already, sign up for our free magazine, Acts and Facts, as well as our devotional booklet, Days of Praise. And you can do that by signing up on paper, or you can use that QR code that's there at the bottom of the screen. You can just take a picture of it with your phone, and that will take you to the place on our website that will enable you to sign up. And please tell your friends about the Discovery Center. We hope more people will come and visit. And I hope this little talk's been a blessing to you, and I think we can open it up for questions now. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hebert. Okay. All right. Do we have any questions today from our in-house audience?
Yes, and please don't be bashful. Yeah. Yes. No, afraid not. I'm afraid not. I think, you know, there was talk about maybe doing that at some point, but then the COVID kind of derailed everything. But it's possible we might make a DVD out of this eventually.
There's a lot of material there for sure.
Right, yeah.
Yes. Any other questions?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
That they have some value as far as relative, but not the absolute.
Right.
Which, I don't know if you could comment a little bit, but I guess I found myself rather dismissive.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's sort of a debate among creationists. There are creationists who are with you who say, oh, we shouldn't trust them at all. They don't have any value at all. But there are a lot of other creationists that I really respect, like Russ Humphreys and others, who say, no, we think there is. You can use them to get relative ages. There is a trend. There are trends. There are things that you have to take into account, like accelerated nuclear decay, and that would explain why sometimes you have different methods on the same rock disagreeing, because not all the heavy nuclei had their decay rates accelerated by the same amount. So if you're totally skeptical of radioisotope dating, you're not alone. And I'll admit, I'm not an expert in that particular area, but there are a lot of creationists that I really respect who say, there is a trend there, and we shouldn't just totally dismiss it. Yeah.
Very good. And of course, I'll point out something you mentioned a moment ago, our magazine, Acts and Facts. It's a great resource. There's articles in there from Dr. Jake, as well as another physicist of ours, Dr. Vernon Cupps, and he's written a book on radiometric dating that we carry here in our Discovery Store. So check that out if you want to learn a little bit more from a nuclear physicist.
Right.
So other questions from our in-house audience? I don't see any here on YouTube, but if you've got a question, those of you watching on YouTube, post it in the comments. We've got a few minutes. We can address some of those. Any other questions?
Yes.
That's a great point. Yes. So this is being streamed to YouTube. It'll be available on YouTube on our YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/ICROrg. And you can go there to that page, and I think it's under videos. It should be under a category called Virtual Classroom. That's what we're calling these presentations each week. And while I'm on that subject, I'll just mention that each Wednesday we do stream these presentations that are right here in Founders Hall. So next week on Wednesday, we will have Mr. Frank Sherwin talking about scientific evidences for creation. Those of you that are here in the Metroplex, here in the audience today, if you want to come back next week and hear that presentation, we would love to have you right here in this room again at the same time. And for that matter, this Friday, 11:05, same time, this Friday, Dr. Hebert will be giving a presentation. Unfortunately, we won't be live streaming that for those of you watching on YouTube, but those of you here in the building, come back on Friday and you can learn about global warming and a Christian response to that topic. So Let's see here. Oh, well, someone was talking about climate change on our comments. Yes. Well, they're asking if we'd be streaming it, but the answer is not this time around, but be checking back on our YouTube channel each week, because we have a different scientist and a different topic covered each time. Last call. Any other questions? Let me ask you this. Have you seen our new planetarium show? Okay. Well, we've got three planetarium shows here at the Discovery Center. One is about the oceans and ocean life, and the other two are about astronomy and our universe. And just last week, we unveiled our brand new planetarium show on
Exploring
deep space. Right. I haven't seen it yet. I need to see it.
It's good. It's good. Oh, yes. Yeah.
Everything I've heard is very good about what's in the show. So if you're here today, check that out. That's I'm sure, a really good production from what I hear. So those of you watching online, come visit us sometime. We'd love to have you here to see all the different exhibits and shows that we've got here at the ICR Discovery Center. Okay, one question real quickly from YouTube, and we'll wrap up with this. Our friend Ujan in India, he's asking, is all the evidence of 130 years or so about magnetic data of decay enough to make an accurate prediction of the age of Earth?
I think it can give you an upper limit. I don't think you can... I don't know if it can give you a precise number like 6,000 years, but it's definitely consistent with recent creation. It's definitely you're looking at upper limits, and like I said, I mean, we're talking a number that's in tens of thousands of years. 100,000 years would be an extremely generous upper limit. So that's obviously consistent with creation just 6,000 years ago.